to their contract.
They just mildly object because they need the product.
Yeah.
So it's bad that they, you know.
Well, it's the example of that is that Greater Southeast. We've got, what, $30,000 in monthly billings that we send out every month on them.
A lot of theirs
plus
are like on
casual agreements that they have. We're probably earning $50,000 to $60,000 a month cash in advance.
On new business.
Now, this is not an exact science. You know, this is, it's like the critical vendor situation. When the food purveyor said to Kmart, we won't sell you even for cash unless you pay us our pre-petition debt, they were violating the automatic stay. That says you can't do any act to collect your pre-petition debt. But they were critical. They were necessary. And Kmart wasn't going to say, Judge, look what they're doing. Because while they're fighting over it for 6 months, they don't have to sell to them. It's the same kind of thing here. You're almost a critical vendor, and you've created your own critical vendor status by saying, we want cash in advance on this contract. And if they really need you, they're going to do it.
And if we didn't do that, and we went 6 months of piling up some more debt because they weren't paying on time, and they converted to 7, we've been harmed again.
Yeah, you have.
We actually had that happen to us.
Now, that gets to the issue, which I'd like to reserve toward the end, on doing business with a debtor in possession and how those decisions should be made. There are some issues about selling into a risky situation and a bankruptcy. It's not automatic. You know, there's this old sort of curbstone law that says, oh, you know, we're a debtor in possession. You can sell to us on credit because we have to pay you. The law says we have to pay you. Well, Phil's right. If they crash and burn and there's no money left, they don't have to pay you. So, but we will get to that. All right, so executory contracts, in theory, we're supposed to perform. The debtor's the one that gets to make the choice. The difference between lease and conditional sale at this point is that 365D10, the section that says after 60 days the debtor's supposed to pay, applies to leases. It doesn't apply to conditional sales. Okay, you with me? A conditional sale is nothing other than a secured claim at that point. You're like the bank who has a lien on the equipment. And there's nothing in the code that says the bank has to get its regular payments. What the code says about that is the bank is entitled to adequate protection of its interest. Now that, what does that mean? Who knows what that means? That means whatever the judge wants it to mean on the day she wants it to mean. No? It means the judge will tell the debtor what they have to do to keep the bank from getting hurt any worse than they were on day one. That might mean making interest payments. It might mean making sure the debtor pays the first lien. You know, if it's a second lien that's complaining, it might mean paying the taxes on the real estate. It might mean making sure it's insured. Whatever the court decides under the circumstances is reasonable to keep the lender at that level where they were on day one. That's what a secured creditor is entitled to, not contract payments. A lease is entitled to contract payments. So there is a real important distinction, a real important practical result of the distinction that's made between lease and lease intended as security. So on that, on those two items, there have been two big risk points so far that we've covered. One is, if you don't have a UCC-1 filed on your lease and it turns into a lease intended as security, you're in trouble. And the second is, if you have a lease intended as security in a Chapter 11, you are not entitled to your contract payments. Whereas in a true lease, you are. There are clear-cut cases on both ends. You know, there are the leases that say you rent. I mean, you have a document, a DLL document that's a rental agreement. And it says you're renting this equipment. Well, that's pretty clearly a true lease. And then you have some deals out there that maybe in the past that had a dollar purchase option or you know, somebody hand wrote, you'll own the equipment at the end of this lease. That's pretty clearly a lease intended as security. It's in the middle that it's unclear, and depending upon the facts and the debtor's situation, they may or may not contest our attempt to get lease payments starting with the 60th day. There was a recent case in Connecticut where the judge, bankruptcy judge, said, while there is a good faith contest pending, the debtor doesn't have to make the lease payments. So where there was a good faith contest about whether it's a lease intended as security or not, the debtor doesn't have to make the lease payments. Now, I think the better view would be the debtor has to pay them in escrow or something like that, so that you can't get 6 months or a year down the road and the debtor says, oh, you know what, you're right, it is a lease, but I don't have the money to pay, so I'll start now. That's part of the analysis that we do on every new account that we get that's a bankruptcy with your documents. We go through to see, to make some judgment as to whether it's a true lease, lease intended as security, whether we should be getting payments, whether we have to do something else. You know, if it's a lease intended as security, maybe we have to move for adequate protection. Sometimes adequate protection is the contract payments. It's really a question of what you can negotiate too. And if we're a really small number in a really big case, we'll probably get it, you know, because the business people way down in the world of reality want to keep the equipment and buy the product. You know, the lawyers may be up there in the ivory tower saying, well, I don't know if this is a lease. We may not have to pay this. You know, we could save this $272 a month or whatever. And the business people say, forget, you know, we're just going to pay it. So we do that analysis on each case, and then we move appropriately with Debbie and Julie's advice on how much pressure we want to bring, and I, you know, I really have to commend them because they're appropriately tough. You know, we have some clients that are really wimps. You know, that they Debbie can be brutal.
Question, in your experience with Beckman, how many true leases have you seen in our documentation?
Well, I think you have a lot of them.
Really?
I think you have a lot of them. The ones that are dangerous, I mean, the one, I just reviewed the current documentation, and I think it's the next gen.
The one that has the fair market value at the bottom?
The list that says you're getting this equipment and the list price of such and such, and we're going to give you an allowance of that amount.
Yeah, this one right here.
Even though the document, even though the boilerplate says Beckman keeps title, Richard and I have discussed the fact that this is significantly dangerous.
It's an easy agreement that he has.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, easy reagent rental plan, because it shows two pieces of equipment, list price $323,300, allowance $323,300, balance zero, and it says. Allowances of 323.3 are granted upon the purchase of the reagents, da-da-da-da-da. In other words, you go to the full term of the reagent agreement, and you don't have to pay for this equipment, which had a list price of 323, and you've been given full credit. That sounds to me like you sold it to them. It doesn't take a very creative debtor or debtor's lawyer or trustee to say, wait a minute, you've transferred the full value of this to the debtor. This is a conditional sale. And you may very well have a UCC-1 filed, which is fine if there's a default, but if there's no default, I'd say more likely than not, if anybody questions it, at the end of that contract, they own the equipment. So that's one of the things Richard and I discussed, that you may want to think about a wording change. I mean, clearly, you know, from the sales perspective, it's nice to say to this customer, look, on this deal, we're giving you $323,000 worth of value over the 5 years. But there has to be another way to say it so that you're not giving them the equipment.
But that's what they want to hear. Give me the equipment, I'll buy all that juice.
We'll give you the equipment for the 5 years. You know, you won't have to pay anything for this equipment for 5 years while you're buying the juice. You know, it's just a question of how you say it. And this is, you know, for for everything else in the world except, you know, UCC law and bankruptcy law, that's probably great and it probably works. Unfortunately, there's this whole body of law that says, well, you actually sold that to them.
So what should we say?
I don't know the exact words. And well, Rich and I discussed this yesterday. But and we'll come up with a suggestion. And it won't be it won't be paragraphs and paragraphs and paragraphs.
You sell them any jokes?
No.
Very rare.
You started to move away from that.
Very rare.
Purely
those in the next generation leases are gone.
Okay. Well, good. I've seen over the years some transactions where there's a document out there. I know that some of your contracts, or maybe all of them, will incorporate a proposal. I've seen some strange things on those proposals. Maybe they're not strange to you, but things that give a lot of rights that, in hindsight, you really don't want them to have. Like, you know, at the end of the deal, you own the equipment. Or, like, you know, you can buy the equipment for a dollar at the end. You have to be careful, because in the sales process, you say things that you mean something, and maybe your customer knows what you mean, but the law might interpret it as something different when it's incorporated. And just parenthetically, if it's not being done now, these documents that incorporate proposals, it would be great if the proposals stayed with the contracts. I mean, I know that sometimes we've had problems in the past where a customer will give us a document that we don't have, that says, oh, by the way, you'll own the equipment, you know, or something like that.
So we should avoid using our proposal, even though it has boilerplate, as the contract.
Yeah. Should be. I mean, we got proposals and then we have agreements in the same package.
I think your house counsel have to deal with the boilerplate issue and making sure that the terms and conditions are appropriate. If you're going to incorporate the proposal into the contract, you have to make sure that they're not contradictory terms and conditions, and that it's something that you want to live with. You know, all this little stuff on the back, really, you know, it's something you never have to worry about until the deal goes bad, right? And that's when it's important. And you want to make sure that it says what you want it to say, because people aren't going to read it anyway. You may as well have it right for you. Okay. When I talked earlier about a Chapter 7, the trustee taking the money and distributing it according to statutory priorities, I didn't go over...
Rich.
Yes, Rich.
Side letters.
Joe.
A little nervous laughter here. Everybody's looking at Joe. They're pointing fingers. Side letters. The contract itself may say that this supersedes anything else, and this is the agreement between the parties. And let's see if it's in there. It's probably in here somewhere.
Yeah,
it says, nothing else matters except this contract.
Right.
And that's fine unless the side letter has something important in it. like when we're trying to enforce the lease and the customer comes up with a letter that says, don't worry about what the documents say. At the end of the lease, you'll get the equipment.
We've never seen anything like that.
Understandably, the interplay is such that most of these contracts never see the light of day. I mean, they never see a default. They never see a problem. You know, most of your deals don't go bad. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. But when they do, these are the problems that we see. The documentation doesn't match up to the deal, especially in an active institution where you're changing equipment, and you know, we've traded this, we've upgraded that, we got all these pieces of equipment, things moving in and out, and the documentation never quite catches up with the actuality. The contracts may not have the right serial numbers, the UCC filings may not have caught up or may not have the right serial numbers. Those sorts of things, when they get to us, you know, in the patients on the operating table, those are when those things become important. So if they don't hurt you at the front end, it would really be helpful to us and to credit and collections on the back end if they were done right. I mean, you know, it's a matter of policy. If as to how much risk you're going to take, how much you're going to spend on perfecting the documentation and the liens. I mean, there are some clients. There are lots of companies who have dollar limits for UCC filings. They just say, look, you know, on anything under $10,000, we're just not going to do it. We're going to take the risk. If we lose a couple of them a year, we lose a couple. But we're not going to spend $200 on 10,000 deals just to protect a couple. So those are the sorts of policy decisions that a company has to make. Okay, the distribution priorities are pretty simple, and some of it's sort of intuitive. The first amount of money that comes out of the liquidation of assets would be any liens, any secured claim on it. So the secured creditors get paid first. Less generally, their share of the expense of liquidation.
When you say first, you mean after the lawyers?
No, actually, thank you for that plug. But no, actually before the lawyers. Technically speaking, the trustee in a bankruptcy does not administer property that is fully liened. But if there is a benefit to the secured creditor in the estate doing something with the property, that secured creditor can be charged with the expense of administration, including trustees' fees, lawyers' fees, etc. After secured claims, the first people that get paid are expenses of administration. In a Chapter 11, that's all the ongoing vendors, all the attorneys. There aren't any trustees' fees, but accountants, all those normal things of operating the Chapter 11 get paid next. After that come the priority unsecured creditors. Things like wages up to that $4,650 limit. Contributions to employee benefit plans up to a certain limit. Consumer deposits up to something like $900. Certain taxes. There's about 8 or 9 priorities before you get down to general unsecured creditors, and then after general unsecured creditors comes equity holders, shareholders, etc. When you think of a Chapter 7 liquidation, it's like a cascade, like a waterfall. You know, all the top claims are paid first, and then all the next claims, and then all the next claims, and all the next claims as far as it goes.
Until you're out of money.
Until you're out of money. Now, the issue that you were alluding to earlier, Phil, was what happens in a Chapter 11 when there are administrative creditors and it busts. It converts to a Chapter 7, liquidates. The expenses of administration of the Chapter 11 drop down a level, because then they're replaced by the expenses of administration of the Chapter 7. So in this cascade, all of the trustees' fees and the lawyers' fees and the liquidators' fees and all of those things in the Chapter 7 get paid first before any Chapter 11 expenses get paid. And when Chapter 11 expenses get paid, they get paid pro rata if there's not enough money to pay them all. And if there's not enough money to pay them all, then the priority unsecureds get nothing. So, if you have a Chapter 11 administrative claim and the debtor doesn't pay it, there's no guarantee that you're going to get paid. You have to make, if you're trying to guess as to whether you're going to get paid, It's just like making an initial credit decision. You analyze the Chapter 11 debtor. So let's just segue from that to doing business with a Chapter 11 debtor. Maybe a little out of turn here, but actually it's getting close. Yeah. This would be 4E, doing business with a debtor in possession. The bankruptcy code says that a debtor in possession can incur unsecured debt in the ordinary course of business without court approval. It's authorized to go out, conduct its business, and incur unsecured debt without asking anybody. But if it can't get unsecured credit, and it needs something else, then it needs court permission. So if it wants to borrow money to operate, we talked about the first day debtor in possession loan, needs court approval. If it wants to go out and buy equipment and grant the seller of that equipment a security interest for the payment, it has to get court approval. When you get to leases, it's not quite clear. If, and some of this also is just a practical issue. In big cases, a lot of things that maybe, there's a gray area. And if it's in the gray area and it's not a big deal, and nobody complains, maybe you don't have to go to court to get it approved and cause all that fuss and all that expense. But if you were doing it strictly by the book, by the black letter of the law, if you want to do a lease with a debtor in possession, it ought to be approved by the court in advance to make sure you are fully protected.
So I'm going to cancel this contract, buddy, and we're going to enter into a brand new one.
Well, you can't say that. The debtor can say that. You can't cancel their contract because they have the right to assume or reject it. You don't have that right. The risk of doing a deal with a debtor in possession and not getting it approved is that somebody in the future, when it goes bad, says, you didn't do it right. What you have is an unsecured claim, a pre-petition unsecured claim. You have no priority. That's the risk. Now, of course, the other risk, even if you decide to do it with court approval, the other risk is the credit risk. Is this a good deal to go into? And forget the idea that the debtor has to pay you. The debtor doesn't have to pay you. We've got 50 cases going on right now where the debtor, not Beckman cases, fortunately. Yeah, where the debtor is not paying its administrative expenses. They are what we term administratively insolvent. They're not making enough money to pay their administrative expenses. So if you go into a deal with a debtor in possession, you ought to be doing a credit analysis just like you would on anybody else.
It's been my experience that in the case of hospital, when they file bankruptcy, reorganization, they do not address the root causes of that bankruptcy. They get out of a little debt, but those root causes continue.
I can't disagree with you. And it's not just hospitals. It's many, many companies. I mean, the last statistics I saw, the last study that was done, which is about 10 years ago, was that approximately 10% of Chapter 11 cases consummate their claims. That means pay anything to creditors. The other 90% fail.
So when they fail, that's it? End of business?
It's liquidated. Now, liquidated might be sale as a going concern, but okay. This debtor, these people, no longer are around. Okay. But 10% consummate, and the other statistic was that they paid an average of about 10% to the creditors.
Wow.
So when you take the whole, and 10% on any individual case distribution is not really bad. When you see that it's like, what is that? Overall, like a 1%, you know, 1% of Chapter 11 creditors ever get paid. It may be a little more than that once you get into liquidation. But, so dealing with, that's the risk of dealing with a Chapter 11 debtor. You have the court supervision risk that if you don't get it approved, somebody might be able to attack it later and have you made an unsecured creditor. You have the normal credit risk, which is, depending on your perspective, either made worse or made better by there being in a Chapter 11. I mean, there is an advantage to there being in a Chapter 11. There are lots of people they don't have to pay. But what's their cash flow? Are they making, you know, are they making money? Those sorts of elementary questions have to be answered before you go into a deal with them.
Do we see any accounts in Chapter 11, or are they more 7s?
11. Oh, they're almost all 11s.
Yeah. I think that
they start out as 11s.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think the good point you made there is the fact that I think there's a misassumption that once they file that you will get paid. And I have seen in certain areas that we have contracts out there and now the opportunity to place new equipment because we're going to get paid, and that's not necessarily so.
Well, there's another side to that coin, and that is if you're going to recover any of that bad debt, the only way you're going to do it is continue to sell through.
Right, but not perhaps not use it as an opportunity to place additional new instrumentation in there before we have a decision on what's out there already.
Usually the first day that I'm notified that they file, they tell me, you will get paid. And I don't know that I've ever been paid except for once. They tell me you will get paid everything.
Well, that's in the standard script for debtors and
conventions. And I say,
this is just temporary. We intend to pay everybody. You know, this is just temporary.
But that's how we are protecting ourselves by the cash
in advance.
We are making sure that we're not incurring any more debt going forward.
I had no idea that they had 60 days. They've never
we're not going to let them know.
He's totally
I did not know that.
They have 60 days
on the lease payments.
On the lease payments.
But we still got those too.
Yeah, if they pay, they're allowed to pay.
You know, you said earlier, keep your mouth shut.
They're allowed to pay.
I did not hear that.
60 days to decide, not 60 days to pay.
Yeah.
Well, no, they have 60 days. There's that 60-day window that they don't have to pay.
Yeah.
They have to pay after that.
But
you have to provide them the service. Like, for argument's sake, because some of our contracts include a service provision that if the system breaks, we're in there. Do we have to send somebody out or end up pointing at that 60 period?
Now you get to that risk issue, Roger. I think probably the better analysis, the more appropriate analysis is that you should provide the service.
Yeah.
The debtor gets the right to choose. And while it's choosing, you should have to perform. But you shouldn't have to go to great risk. And that great, you know, how much risk is where the fuzziness happens. And we've chosen not to take any risk. And so far, the debtors have not really complained. You know, this is kind of like those policy decisions. We're gonna push as hard as we can push. And when somebody pushes back, we'll then decide whether we change our policy.
Well, we have done a little bit of change where if a customer doesn't want to pay cash in advance, we will take a deposit and use up their money, let's say $10,000, and until they get shipped out up to that point, till that's gone, you don't get any more. So we're not taking any risk, no.
And it seems to be working. I want to jump back to another definitional item, 4C4, preferential transfer. This is another big area that we start to see, and we're seeing it more and more everywhere, all around the country, all sorts of cases. This is I called it the double whammy. This is not only does the customer owe you money that you're not going to get because they went into bankruptcy, but the trustee or the customer wants some back that you got just before they filed. That's a preferential transfer. A transfer or a payment. It's not just a payment. It could be the granting of a lien or a transfer of title or anything like that. It's a transfer to a creditor or for the benefit of a creditor on account of old debt made while the debtor's insolvent and there's a presumption that they're insolvent during the 90 days before they file bankruptcy, and made during the preference period, which is generally 90 days unless you're a related party, an insider, and then it's 1 year. So again, what that means in English is you have a customer, let's forget the lease situation, let's say it's just all straight sale stuff, and they owe you $100,000 for old invoices, and Debbie really pounds them, and they say, all right, we'll make a partial payment, we'll make a $25,000 payment, and they do, and 30 days after that, they file bankruptcy. That payment is probably a preference, a preferential transfer, which can be taken back by the debtor.
But they have to ask.
Very, very important thing. Not only do they have to ask, you never, ever, ever write the check, do you? No. Never give it back when they ask.
And we kick and scream until they ask.
Right. Because there are plenty of defenses. And there are lots of opportunities to negotiate. So if you get asked, never write the check. Start to analyze the defenses.
But now you're not dealing with the debtor. You're dealing with the trustee.
Well, it could be the debtor. It could still be the debtor, or it could be a creditor's committee. In a Chapter 11, the debtor is entitled to recover preferences.
But other than ordinary course of business, what are the other possible defenses?
One, as you said, is ordinary course of business. This payment was just like all the other payments we've been getting for months and months and months. Even though our terms say 30 days, this debtor has always paid between 40 and 45 days, always pays all of its creditors between 40 and 45 days, and this $25,000 was, in fact, between 40 and 45 days. It's in the ordinary course of business. That's probably a good defense. The other good defense is, because the way this usually happens is, the customer says, we need more reagents. And Debbie says, you're not getting any reagents. And they say, we need $25,000 worth. And she says, I'll tell you what, you make a $25,000 payment on account, and I'll ship you, on regular terms, another $25,000 worth of product. And then they go into bankruptcy and they don't pay that second shipment. Then the trustee comes back, or the debtor comes back and says, you know that $25,000 you got? Give it back. It was on account of old invoices. It met all the tests. It's a preference. Give it back. And our response is, wait a minute. We went out of pocket another $25,000 because you made that payment. We wouldn't have shipped that. We wouldn't have given you that new value. And that's what that defense is, a subsequent new value. We only shipped that $25,000 in reliance on that payment, and we shouldn't have to eat both. And that's a good defense. It has to be, the timing has to be that way, though. It can't be.